In this video, we'll address one of the most commonly asked questions about the F256 product line, which is, what's the difference between the F256K, here on my left, and the F256 Jr, which I have here in a case on my right. A video was just released by Peter, who goes by the name Tail Recursive, on YouTube, unboxing, so to speak, or giving a first look at the F256K. It does a really nice job in covering it end to end in about 25 minutes. So I'll try not to repeat too much of what he says there, but I'll address the basics and the basic differences between these two systems. To start with, the K has a built-in keyboard, and the 66-key mechanical key switch type keyboard is provided to your own specification in terms of key switches. This one happens to have a blue key switch installed. You can get blue, brown, red, or black, I believe. I believe it's those four choices. So blue, you can hear the clickiness of it. I prefer brown. I'm a very hard typer, loud typer. You probably heard that in some of my other videos. But this prototype system was built with blue, and it's a really nice keyboard. I mean, from a layout perspective, it kind of combines a vintage Commodore look with a modern keyboard, in that you have inverted T, cursor keys, Alt, Control, Tab, where you would expect it. It has Commodore style function keys, F1 through F8, clear home, insert, delete, restore, run, stop, and it's got a Foenix key. Since we're in the 2000s now, been here for a while already, you'll notice that the keyboard itself has what you would expect, and a shifted 4 is a dollar sign, a shifted 2 is an at sign, not a quote, as it was on the original Commodore keyboards. But this is wired into kind of a second controller built into the F256K, and the kernel is equipped to recognize which key is being pressed, which keyboard is present, and arbitrating between one of three different types of keyboards, actually. So though this comes with a built-in keyboard, there's nothing stopping you from plugging in your own keyboard in the PS2 port in the back. So if something like this is more appealing to you, have at it. You can plug that in. I wouldn't. It really speaks to what do you want out of your machine and what kind of experience do you want. To me, this machine has soul. This machine makes you feel a certain way about it. And you'll probably get the idea once you use it for a little while. There's nothing like turning on a machine and having everything where you expect, not having to mess with a bunch of external connectivity, wiring, etc. And you'll see the way I run my life, which is, well, I don't quite know how to say it, but I've got wires all over the place. And if you've seen the background of my studio here, you'll understand what I'm talking about. Let me quickly shift gears to the Junior and talk about what it comes with, what it looks like, and what the capabilities are. Where the K has a built-in keyboard, the Junior has, well, no keyboard, right? In fact, it doesn't have a case. In fact, it doesn't have a DC power connector built into it or power supply built into it. It comes as an ITX mini board, and it's a relatively low-cost system. I haven't checked the latest prices, but I believe it was selling for somewhere between $200 and $220. When it was most recently being shipped. I'll show you what you get when you buy one. I have an Rev-A development system, but it's the same form factor, so let me grab that now. So if you haven't seen it up close and personal, this is a ITX Mini, and you can see based on kind of the relative size of the 40-pin package that you did, the 6502, how large the board is. Again, this is the C256 Jr. Rev-A development system, development board. But the layout is similar on the production Junior. When you get the board, you'll need to provide your own power supply, which is an ITX Mini Pico-type power supply. I believe it's 24-pin or 22-pin. You'll need to have your own monitor, as you will with a K. It's a DVI-I connection, and you'll need to have your own keyboard. Mouse is optional. So that's what you get. But internally, you get a whole lot more. The capabilities of the F256 line include a very powerful graphics engine, which is identical between the two systems. It includes a megabyte of memory, which I believe is configured as 512 RAM, 512 flash, but then you can also optionally add additional 256 or I think 512 flash or RAM to that. I'll talk about that in just a moment. From a connectivity perspective, these two systems are near identical, but there are a few slight differences which I'll address. And then from a audio perspective, there's also some slight differences. The RTX mini form factor, as I mentioned, has two open SID slots. The F256K comes with two Gideon instances built into a second FPGA on the system board, which this does not have, which means that you can run any piece of software that would be looking for a SID out of the box here, which is very nice. They both have a pair of PSG instances built into them. The F256K has an additional sound chip, which is a Yamaha 262, YMF262 OPL3, which is a very capable stereo IC. And there's some software coming out, the trackers and things that are just starting to leverage that now. You don't get that in the Junior. Otherwise, the only difference to speak of between the two from a memory map perspective has to do with these three full color RGB lights. On this prototype system, they're on all the time, but they are typically bound to shift lock, drive access, media access, and power. And again, there's memory locations where you can just poke or store values into and change these if you feel like customizing it. So that's pretty interesting. Of course, the Junior has a media access lights, a power light, an LED, not a shift lock light. That would be on your keyboard. That's really, I think, an on and off affair. The header has connectivity for what would be your power switch. So if and when I plug this in, you'll notice the power light comes on and the drive access light just blinked just for a moment. So memory map wise, it probably just doesn't do anything on this system. But of course, status lights are there and the kernel addresses them appropriately. What else can I cover here? Let's see. So that's kind of some of the physicals, the keyboard versus no keyboard, the difference in sound and audio. I should probably talk about just briefly connectivity from a port perspective. I won't go through all of them, but I'll tell you that the K comes with two joystick ports on the right, and of course a reset button, a power switch, a serial port, and other ports. The Junior has those ports as well, but only some of them are wired. The rest are available on headers. So it's up to you, to wire them or use them or not. In this system, I'm wired in through my serial USB debug port to an external USB type A. I have my barrel connector for power, but not much else. On this model, which is another one, yeah, I have two of them, I know. I have an SD extension, which simply plugs in here, so I don't have to be reaching behind a series of wires. I can just have a remote SD card. We'll pull this out of here just to show you. And these are inexpensive, probably like $5 or $8 on AliExpress. So I save the hassle of fishing for pulling this out if I happen to be accessing my SD card quite a bit. I also have wired in a reset switch here. This red switch is kind of a momentary. I've also wired in a boot to flash or RAM switch on mine. I've also wired in a joystick port here. I've also wired in an external DB9 serial port to mine. And then I have hardwired, believe it or not, to the same header, the USB debug port. To each his own. I like to wire things. I like to play. Some people just want to get down to work and play or develop software. So a lot of options. People do ask, why is this expensive? Or why does it cost what it costs? And the answer is because you get a lot. You get the enclosure, of course, that costs money. I believe this enclosure probably cost me around $60. But there are more expensive enclosures for sure. You can easily spend $200 or more on an enclosure. This system comes with all the ports wired and usable as shipped. You don't have to worry about buying connectors, crimping them on, going through the hassle. This system comes with an internal DC to DC power converter. Here you need to buy your Pico power converter. This system comes with a pair of Gideon SID instances inside of a second FPGA. In this system, you don't get that, you'll need to buy SID chips. Those are 50 or 60 bucks each, kind of aftermarket. So that's another 120 bucks, let's say. This system has a mouse connection on the outside of it. The Junior does not. You'll have to wire in a header for the mouse connection. What else? There's probably a few more, to be honest with you. But, you know, roughly $220. I believe the price as of this date is $595 here. So when you get done adding up the cost of the inside power supply, of SID instances, of a case, of a keyboard, and all of the hassle of wiring up these various ports, you're getting pretty darn close to what you have here. I find this a value, to be honest. But I'll need to go on and say that for some people, you may want to do more with your system, like wire in the 20-pin Commodore keyboard connector that's available on the Junior. That connector does not exist in the K. Of course, it comes with the keyboard. Why would you want it? One of the options is a kind of a VIA, the Versatile Interface Adapter, for using a vintage Commodore keyboard, and the kernel will support it. It'll support a PS2 keyboard. It'll support a 20-pin Commodore keyboard. And in the case of a K, it also supports the 66 key in a 9x8 keyboard matrix with a second VIA. So I'm mentioning a bunch of acronyms and other things, but I at least want to say that from a simplistic example, I know of people that have Commodore keyboards and love the Commodore keyboards, and they've taken their Junior and adapted a Commodore keyboard to work with the Junior, which is just a tremendous experience. I happen to have one here, which I'll show you. So this is my VIC-20, and while I've taken it apart and recapped it and done things to it, mine has the vintage PET, the original PET keyboard on it. And, you know, if I was of the mind, I could easily take this out, take the top of half of the clamshell off, wire it into the Junior, and have an integrated platform that's, you know, really appealing. But again, that's personal preference. It's up to you whether that appeals to you or whether you want to go through the trouble of it. I'll need to touch on one last item, I think, before we kind of close this, which has to do with cartridges and memory expansion. So I mentioned that, the Junior has the PCI X1 slot built in for memory expansion. The K has an actual bona fide cartridge slot in here. This is a prototype cartridge, though the shipping cartridges look a lot like this, except they'll have a decal on them. This is a 256K RAM cartridge, and it plugs in very easily. On the Junior, you can buy a cartridge, or rather a card, which provides the same capability, which slides into the slot also very easily. And these are actually interchangeable. I don't know why you would want to take this and put it in the slot here, but you could if you wanted to. If you had maybe a pair of these and you only wanted to buy one cartridge and use it between the two, you certainly could. You could also take this cartridge and put it in here and use it on this system. So interchangeable. Otherwise, I think I've addressed everything that I set out to. Look at my list here. Yeah, that about does it, I think. Hopefully this has been helpful and addresses some of your questions. I should say just briefly that there's a lot more on the board, on both boards, than meets the eye. And though you look at a board, it seems rather sparse. Foenix Retro includes things like, physical Wolfson codec, audio circuitry, a Texas Instruments real-time clock chip, which provides additional timers. There's a whole slew of hardware built on the board that just come natively with all of the Foenix systems that you wouldn't necessarily have on other systems. So they're really highly integrated. It's a really efficient packaging. They're very reliable. It's really a great product. And I'm saying this as a consumer. You know, I don't get any of this stuff for free. I pay for all my equipment. But I'm a big fan. I've been on board for about 2 years now. And I just invite you to take a closer look. Leave a comments or questions if you have below, and I'll do my best to answer them. Alternatively, you can jump onto the Foenix Discord. There'll be a link to that as well for more information, and you can capture a lot of the dialogue and activity going on across the community. A lot of folks developing a lot of exciting software.